Thank you. Thank you, Tom. It's beautiful. Thank you. Welcome, everyone. It must be summertime. I know a few folks warned me. They said, we're going to be gone for a few. So that's good. Wherever two or three are gathered, I said earlier, there we keep the service shorter. So this is the 10th. Okay, for those of you online, there's a loud motorcycle going by. Welcome to those of you online too. We fixed the Facebook problem a couple weeks ago. It's different, so I cannot read your responses or say hello back to you or anything until after the service. So do please say hello so that we know that you're worshiping with us, and thank you for being here. I invite you all now to stand as you are able, and we will sing the gathering song, All Who Hunger, Gather Gladly. Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Have mercy on us, Lord.
Have mercy on us, Lord, and hear our solemn prayer. It saves us from despair. Have mercy on us, Christ, and wash away our sin. Pour out your grace and make us whole, that new life may begin. Have mercy on us, Lord, make sin and shame depart, renew us with your saving create in us new hearts.
The Lord has renewed us with his saving power and created in us new hearts. And in thanksgiving and gratitude, we sing, glory be to God in heaven. Epoule kako, let us pray. Gracious God, you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share this bread with all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of the word.
Our first reading comes from 2 Kings 4, verses 42 to 44. A reading from 2 Kings. A man from Baal Shalisha, bringing food from the first fruits to Elisha, the man of God, 20 loaves of barley and fresh ears of grain in his sack. Elisha said, "Give it to the people and let them eat." But his servant said, "How can I set this before 100 people?" So he repeated, Give it to the people and let them eat, for thus says the Lord, they shall eat and have some left. He set it before them, they ate and had some left, according to the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is from Psalm 145, verses 10 through 18. We will read half verse upon half verse. All your works shall praise you, O Lord.
And your faithful ones shall bless you.
They shall tell of the glory of your kingdom.
And speak of your power.
That all people may know of your power.
And the glorious splendor of your kingdom.
Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Your dominion endures throughout all ages.
You, Lord, are faithful in all your words and loving in all your works.
The Lord upholds all those who fall
and lifts up those who are bowed down.
The eyes of all wait upon you, O Lord.
And you give them their food in due season.
You open wide your hand
and satisfy the desire of every living thing.
You are righteous in all your ways
and loving in all your works.
You are near to all who call upon you.
Please stand for the gospel acclamation and the reading of the gospel.
Hallelujah, Lord and Savior, open now your saving word. Let it burn like fire within us. Speak until our hearts are stirred. Hallelujah, Lord, we sing for the good news that you bring.
The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." When Jesus realized they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. There always seems to be one scripture reading that doesn't quite fit with all the rest, and since we were a smaller group today, I decided let's let that one go. How does that sound? Okay. And even with that, I kept saying to myself this week as I read Elijah and John, or 2 Kings and John, the story of Elisha, the successor to Elijah, what do I preach on? Feeding 5,000, walking on the water, calming the sea. In John and in Mark, the feeding of the 5,000 and the walking on the water go side by side. In Matthew, they're split. In Luke, Jesus never walks on water. Luke is really interested in feeding people, but he's not too interested in that walk in the water sort of thing. Okay. So I'm going to focus, I think, a little more on the feeding and kind of weave in the walking on the water along the way, or let you weave that in yourself. The first thing I want to note is this, and I think this is true for Hawaii as well as the ancient world, so think about this. Eating is the way we initiate and maintain relationships, right? Think about it. What do you do on a date, on a birthday, on a wedding anniversary, on a holiday? What do? You eat. And what do you do in Hawaii if you're invited to somebody else's house for a meal? You take your own food with you, right? And you show up with your food as well, and everybody eats way too much. And there's always leftovers. And everybody takes them home, right? That's the way it works. When you know when, what, where, and with whom you eat, you know their world and yours. You know the character of the society that they are in. In the ancient world of Jesus' time, food shortages abounded. Famines were frequent. They were one of the three plagues in Scripture, the other two being war and pestilence, right? Famine, war, and pestilence is a phrase repeated throughout the Old Testament. Whoever controlled the food, especially the bread, the staff of life, it's called, because it's what kept people alive when there was nothing else to be had. You can almost trace the history of the ancient world by following the path of wheat and barley farming. Whoever controlled the bread controlled the populace. They controlled the empire. Think about that. Think about in Genesis, when famine struck the promised land, Jacob and his ohana, his sons and their wives and daughters and sons and, right? Everybody packed up and moved to Egypt, the great empire of their day, because Pharaoh had the bread. And the twist in the story is he had the bread because Jacob's son Joseph, who had disappeared, was his prime minister and had a dream and said, we got to save up bread. We got to save the wheat and the barley grain for 7 years. That is only something in the ancient world a great power could do. And to be honest, if you think about it, in our day and age, in 2022, when Russia invaded Ukraine and started messing with the wheat fields, remember how the whole world went kind of, oh no, where are we going to get our bread? Ukrainian wheat fields feed much of the globe. It's still true. Whoever controls the bread controls the empire. The Roman dictators of Jesus' day knew that too, and the emperors. They ruled by a Latin phrase in Rome, circum et panem, the circus and bread. I want to say every now and then, the circus and Panera bread, right? Circum et panem, amusement and food. Whoever fed the mob of Rome best got to be dictator. And as the empire expanded into the Middle East and into Palestine, where Jesus lived, so did the control of the bread, along with a few other pillars of state-sponsored violence. There came the bread, the legions, and healthcare. If you don't pay up for the healthcare, you don't get any. That's just how it is. If you mess with the politics, the legions will take care of you. They will crucify you. And if you don't behave, you don't get any bread. state-sponsored manipulation of famine, war, and pestilence. Two theologians, Christian thinkers I like a lot, Marcus Borg and Dom Crossan, wrote in a book they did together called The Last Week of Jesus. They said, the domination system of the empire, and they called it domination systems, involves the exploitation of the many for the benefit of the few, the aristocracy, with religious justification. God said, this is the way things are ordered. This is the way the world is. Give them enough, however, to keep producing, but limit the leisure time and relaxation where meals are celebrated. Make sure there is nothing left over. They also said that in early Christianity, and I keep finding this fascinating when I read these passages. In early Christianity, there were probably competing sacred rituals in the church. One was a sacrament of bread and wine, communion or Eucharist or the Lord's Supper. The other one was the sacrament of bread and fish. It's possible that the bread and wine sacrament came out of Jewish Christian traditions, and that Gentile Christian traditions emphasized feeding the people who were hungry. And the signs of fish and bread as ritual, as sacrament, were everywhere the first few centuries. They were on paintings on walls. They were on the Christian catacombs in Rome. They were on funerary devices like caskets, urns, and plaques. And they always seemed to have 7 or 11 males, probably apostles. 7 is a holy number. 11 is the apostles minus Judas, right? They always seem to have them sitting at a table with fish and bread. Not wine, but fish and bread. It made me think about how years ago there was talk about in history of the church, they had in the early church, not just an hour of liturgy up, down, in, out, and around, and bound, and gone. They had agape love feasts at the homes of the people who were rich enough to put on the feast. And that out of that feast, which I would assume had bread and fish, came the sacrament of bread and wine. And it kind of just got slimmed down. There was a word for it. Open commensality. Commensality. I had to look that up. It just means eating together at the table. So why can't we just say eating together at the table? It was open to everyone. So when I say, come, all is ready, and you are welcome, I mean you, each and every one of you, just as you are. And that was the other part of this commensality, was you peaceably eat together with people who are not like you, with people who may differ with you on spirituality, theology, ethics, morals, politics, everything. You eat together in peace. And I want to suggest it's what Jesus practiced when he fed the 5,000. Everyone was welcome. You are welcome. Did you see the big kerfluffle about the opening of the Olympic ceremonies? Did anybody see that? Where they had the Feast of Dionysus, you know, one of the gods who started the Olympics millennia ago, and a bunch of fundamentalist Christians had a stroke saying, and they had drag queens, I guess, and a few, not everybody, but there were some drag queens there, and everybody had a stroke that they were mocking the Lord's Supper. And it wasn't even the Lord's Supper. So go figure. Sometimes Christians, we can get a little wound up, too wound up about what's going on, and we just need to chill. Just chill. All right. My goodness. Everyone is welcome. at the Lord's table. So even if there were drag queens at a Last Supper, that's fine. That's fine. Some of them sing and dance very well, and it would go well with the hymns around here, right? Jesus practiced this open commensality, and it was a threat to empire, to domination systems. What did he do in this reading like he did in the Markan reading? He did the same thing he did at communion, the same verbs. He took, gave thanks, broke, and gave the bread. This was Eucharist, communion. Here they kind of say, instead of broke and gave, they say he distributed. But look what he did. He told everyone to sit down, relax, take a break, rest. That's breaking the rules. People ate as much as they wanted. What? Until they were satisfied. Huh? And there were leftovers. Never have leftovers if you want to keep the populace in control. And the people knew what this meant. That's why you get that cryptic phrase, they saw he's a prophet. He's the prophet to come. And Jesus saw, they want to make me king, and that's not what I'm about. And away he went. But that is what the people wanted, to make him king. And that is why the empire killed him. And that is how Jesus became the true king from a cross, a king of suffering love for the sick, the hungry, the shamed. The king of love my shepherd is, we sang last week. His goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever. The sacred ritual of bread and fish seems to have faded. It faded away as Christianity became the religion of empire. As power moved from the communion of saints, the general community, to leadership groups like clergy, monks, priests, bishops, to specific leaders, popes, Holy Roman emperors, that ritual of everyone is welcome at the table faded away. Only in the last 100 years or so have we really begun to take that seriously again. You know what I think we need here more is an agape love feast, more potlucks, more fish fries, or better yet, poke. That's what we need, poke. And I'll stand up here with chopsticks and a tub of poke, and I'll go down there and I'll say to you, the spiced up poke of Christ is sliced up for you. And we shall eat as much as we want until we are satisfied. I think that means stuffed, right? And then we shall gather up the leftovers and do what Jesus did. Feed the hungry. May it be so. Amen. And I promise not to use these with the bread. And the hymn of the day is Break Now the Bread of Life. And I invite you to stand as you are able and let us sing them.
Thank you.
I lost track of the verses. Okay. And while we lose track, let us respond to the God who does not lose track of us by confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. We pray for the church. Bless the ministries of our neighboring congregations throughout Hawaiʻi. Empower churches throughout the world and encourage missionaries who accomplish global neighbors. Kindle us a spirit of cooperation that all people may know your loving works. E kahaku.
E aloha mai.
We pray for creation. Send rain to lands experiencing drought and come to the aid of those enduring sweltering heat. Nourish wheat and barley, taro and coconuts. Crops grown for the nourishment of your people. Conserve aquatic habitats and fish populations. E kahaku. We pray for those who govern, especially in this election season. Cast out arrogance, selfishness, and corruption, and instruct those who lead to practice compassion and humility. Inspire them with a vision of the common good and a commitment to ensure that all who hunger are fed. E kahaku.
E aloha mai.
We pray for those bowed down by heavy burdens, those who are unemployed or underemployed, those unable to find affordable housing, and those without health insurance. Console those who grieve and hear the cries of those who call to you for healing, especially those whom we name silently and aloud.
For the families of Dick Crislip and Benita Chi Kia'aina, for Eileen, Sally, for the houseless of Maui, for those around the world who are dying of hunger, all those with long COVID, Anita, Bob, Bonnie, Darren, Ellen, Gary, Mallory, John, Michael, Richard, Sally, and Steph.
E kahaku.
E aloha.
We pray for this assembly, Christ Lutheran Church. Deepen our resolve to use what we have to serve those in need. When we worry that we do not have enough resources for ministry, assure us of your abundance. E kahaku.
Elohai. Remember those with birthdays this week, especially Sam, Paul, Connie, Janet, Fia, and Ellie. We remember all those who are celebrating baptismal anniversaries, especially Connie. May their days be full of laughter and life and love. E ka haku. We pray for the communion of saints in Waikiki, known as Prince of Peace Lutheran Church, and their pastor Gloria Imamura. May they be faithful witnesses to the God who feeds us no matter who we are. E ka haku.
We give thanks for those who have died. As you sustain them through all their days, so dwell in our hearts that we may have the power to comprehend with all the saints the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. E kahaku.
Elohai.
We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Aloha nui e oko. Oke aloha o ka haku e mau anameako. Apaoloa. Friends and neighbors, brothers and sisters, siblings in Christ, the peace of God be with you always.
Also.
Let us take a moment to share God's peace. You may be seated. And again, having gotten halfway through the year, thank you for your time, your talent, your tithes, your support of Christ Lutheran Church, and our mission to each live Christ's aloha. Tom, would you lead us in Let the Vineyards Be Fruitful, please? As you are able.
Let us pray. God, our provider, we bring nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out of it, except the gifts you have first given us, which we bring to your table, and with them the offerings of our lives. Nourish us now with the life that really is life, revealed to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, O God, creator of heaven and earth. You rescued your covenant people, led them on all their journeys, and taught them by the prophets. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Pour out your Holy Spirit in this meal and make us one in this community of faith and with your people throughout the world. Glory and praise to you, O God, author of life, word made flesh, power of the Most High, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Namakana ake akua, nokapoe ake akua. The gifts of God for the people of God. E komo mai, e kipa mai. Come, all is ready, and you are welcome. And for those of you who are worshiping with us online, if at this time you have bread and wine at hand, I invite you to take it up. And if you don't have anything at hand, you can still commune with Jesus and with us, his people here at Christ Lutheran Church, by receiving these words in faith. The body of Christ is broken for you. The blood of Christ is shed for you.
Let us pray. God of blessing, as at this table we have seen you face to face, and in the gift of Christ's body and blood, our hearts have been refreshed. Send us now to shine with your goodness and bear witness to the one we have received, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Announcements. IHS is next Saturday, first Saturday of August, and so we invite you to make some cookies, buy some cookies, bring some cookies, drop them off, and two of the taste testers will be around. I think one's on vacation, but we'll make sure that it's high quality cookies, and we'll go from there. So, and again, this is the way we live out the gospel reading of today, where we feed the hungry and have some things left over. So I invite you to do that. This Thursday, we're going to have the men's prayer breakfast start up again at 7:30 at Rise and Shine Cafe, which is Malka. And if you like a little more information, you can contact Adam Palmer or the church office or me. And then the talk story time on civic life and faith will continue after the 10 a.m. service, so about 11:15, 11:30. We'll sit down and discuss the rest of the document, Civic Life and Faith, that we've been going through the last few months. And then a while back, we got an AED machine here for starting people back up if they conk out on us here right in the middle of church, and that's happened before. So we had some people who were trained who left, and we found out that with this AED, we can get free training for CPR as well as the AED. And there's a few of us who are very interested in doing this. And if you're interested, let the office know. Let Shelby know or contact Anna Hamaguchi. And we'll set a date probably in the fall when we can gather together here and learn CPR and AED. I think the AED is pretty easy once you get the hang of it. I think that would be a good thing to do. And then I think the statements are going to be sent out soon. I don't think they're on the table, but we keep saying that. So fooled you. And then we'll get those out to you. And if you want to look at the variety show, there's a video there. And then somebody said there's umbrellas in the back, so if it's raining, you can use the umbrella to get to the car, then bring it back next Sunday. And then one final one that's not listed here. In September, probably on Saturdays, we're going to partner with the League of Women Voters and do a voter registration sign up in the parking lot. As a church or in a 501c3, we can't tell you who to vote for, or we're not going to tell you who to vote for. We can tell you what kind of person and character our leaders should have. But we won't tell you who to vote for. We won't even tell you what ballot measures to vote for. So, but we can sign people up to vote. And since Hawaii has such a low voter turnout, we want to encourage people to sign up and actually vote. And I think that's a good way for a democracy to thrive and for people to participate in the voting process. So if you would like to be a part of that, they're going to offer like a one session training on how to sign people up, how to help them do that. And they will have somebody who knows how to do it on hand. I think it'll be every Saturday in September. So this is something that kind of came out of that Civic Life and Faith conversation. And we're kind of excited to see that happen. So if you'd like to help out, let me know. Let Shelby know or Anna Hamaguchi, and we'll go from there. Any other announcements? Good. It's good to see you and have you here. So let's stand and I'll bless you on your way out, and we'll sing on our way out. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Sent forth by God's blessing. Thank you. Thanks be to God.